Wayne, page 480 in your hymnals. I want that mountain. 480. Let's all stand, shall we? Page 480.
I saw the giant of prayerlessness upon the mountain high. He left so hardened by a bending knee. No longer in the wilderness I'll stay, and so I cry. I want that mountain, it belongs to me. I want that mountain, I want that mountain. Where the melting water flow, where the grains of it still grow. I want that mountain, I want that mountain.
Thanksgiving. Wonderful, wasn't it? Weather was good. I don't know what yours is. Ours is just, you try to pack as much in as you can. We have people from out of town, so we just try to, I'm sure y'all do that, but I hope you had everything as well. Hope you're thankful. Right? Pray with me, would you? Your head bowed, your eyes closed. Before we pray, I want you to think about something. I want you to think about the fact that when Jesus died for you, I don't think his goal was that for me or you. I don't think his goal when he died for us, I don't think the goal was just to get us into heaven. I don't think he thought, well, at least if they trust me to get to heaven, I'll be happy with that. No, I think he wants every bit of us. I think he wants every second of our life. I think he wants us to acknowledge that we owe him more than we could ever pay him. You say, well, that sounds like slavery. You know what? It is. Paul called himself, he said, I'm a bond servant of the Lord. And there's nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that. I just hope today that you and anybody else watching this would consider giving the one who died for you, giving him all he wants. Not giving him what you want him to have, but giving him what he wants. I'm going to pray. Dear Father, it's true in us that we're so selfish with our life. You weren't selfish. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. There's no selfishness in that phrase. None. How selfish we are. May you take away today our selfishness. May we care about what you get from us, and may we care what we do for you. There are people today, Lord, there are people that can't be here. They're in pain, they're recovering, they got sick, there's some reason, there's some legitimate reason. But then there are those who just got selfish. And not, I don't want to say it, and I don't want it to come out in the wrong way, but God, the truth is the truth. If they're selfish today and put anything above you, that was the wrong decision. That was a bad decision. So I pray that they'll see that. Thank you today. Thank you for everyone that's come out. And I know there are some that are still gone, celebrating home, away, whatever. Be with them. Use every teacher today to speak to hearts. Thank you, Lord, that you've given us so much. And we do owe you. In fact, you said you're not your own. You're bought with a price. So we want to glorify you in our body and our spirit, which you said belong to you. Speak in this hour. Use this Sunday school time to be a help and a challenge to us. Help us to pray, Lord, like we've never prayed before. Bless this service. I thank all those guys that I love that are pastoring and preaching today, be it our missionaries or other pastors around this country or close to us, may they have your power today. May you encourage them today. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated.
It's time to recognize the birthdays and anniversaries for this week. Birthdays, Fred Senselowski and Ken Kaufman, who is now walking in, the man of the hour. Anyone else have a birthday who we want to embarrass you to? Anybody else have a birthday this week? All right. For Ken.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Ken. Happy birthday to you.
Anniversaries. Jim and Beth Ann Reed have an anniversary. Anyone else have an anniversary this week? All right, when you see them, wish them a happy anniversary. 485, 485, this world is not my home.
Amen. This world is not my home, I'm just a passing through.
Shouting victory, their songs of sweetest praise. complete our course of the month. Thank you, Lord. On the chorus.
I guess if you have a Bible and you want to stay, Genesis 27. I can't. Here's what I did. Let me tell you. Let you in on the pastoral secrets. I said, Lord, I'm ready to go to chapter 28. And I said, well, I'm just going to read chapter 27 again. I read it a couple times. And I just couldn't get that phrase out of my mind as I read that second half of the chapter. Verse 41, Esau hated Jacob. Esau hated Jacob. Esau hated Jacob. Jacob. Hate is such a strong word, isn't it? Did your kids ever say that to you when you took something away? I hate you. And you wanted to respond, I hate you too, but you're my child. I have to love you. But I hate when you act like that. But when you did something for their good, they hate you. They know how hurtful that is. That's why they say it. Christians aren't supposed to hate each other. Are they? Unless I'm missing a verse. Brothers, excuse me. Brothers aren't supposed to hate each other. So, I'm reading through this, and I'm thinking, man, Sunday school, I want to be like everybody else. Just keep going. Get through it. I want you to be like everybody else. You don't pay attention. But we studied that. And then the Lord really convicted me, and he said, hey, I want you to deal with that. And I said, Lord, I can't hear you. My ears are kind of plugged. And I thought you said you wanted me to stay there. You say, you blaming God for this? I am somewhat. Esau, it's called Esau hated Jacob. You cannot control, this is a very important statement, you cannot control how people treat you. But you are in total control of how you treat people. Doesn't say Jacob hated Esau. It says Esau hated Jacob. I don't know what Jacob did. I really don't. I don't know what his response was. Maybe he hated him back. Maybe Esau said to him, I hate you. Maybe Jacob, to hurt him and to relieve himself some, maybe Jacob said, I hate you too. Do you have a girlfriend when you're in grade school? Isn't it funny when we were in grade school and dated, it was like the worst divorce someone could ever go through? If they're on one side of the playground, we went to the other side. They came down the hall. We turned our head. Remember that? Some of you, what? Let's read verse 34. When Esau, Genesis 27, when Esau heard the words of his father, he cried with a great and exceeding bitter cry. Now he cares about the birthright. Did he care when he was hungry? Did he care in a weak moment? Boy, be careful of your weak moments. A whole life, a whole ministry. God help me every day to realize that one bad decision can ruin a lifetime of ministry. A weak moment in your life can ruin a marriage. It can ruin a relationship. One weak moment. Say, what are you getting all wound up about? Because somebody needs to. Am I missing something? Is every guy on this planet a sexual harasser? I'm not. I mean, I'm a annoyer. I'm not an harasser. And I'm thinking, man, everybody's bad. Right? All of a sudden? So 40 years later, oh, by the way, that it hit me. That bothered me what you said to me or did to me 40 years ago, if it's true. Who, you remember 40 years ago? Isaac has blessed Jacob because he tricked his father, right? Deceived his father, wore skin so his dad would think it was Esau. Got the blessing. Esau comes in from trying to please his father. Verse 34, when Esau heard the words of his father, he cried with a great and exceeding bitter cry and said unto his father, bless me, even me also, O my father. He said, thy brother came with subtlety and hath taken away thy blessing. Verse 36, and he said, is not he rightly named Jacob? For he hath supplanted me these two times. He took away my, he didn't take it away. Esau gave it away. He hath taken away my blessing. And he said, hast thou not reserved a blessing for me? And Isaac answered and said unto Esau, behold, I have made him thy Lord. Wow. And all his brethren have I given to him for servants, and with corn and wine have I sustained him. And what shall I do now unto thee, my son? And Esau said to his father, hast thou but one blessing, my father? Bless me, even me also, O my father. And Esau lifted up his voice and wept. Esau doesn't sound like too bad of a guy, does he? I mean, really. Don't you want to be blessed? I do. All of a sudden, he is just broken by what's happening. And Isaac, verse 39, Isaac his father answered and said unto him, behold, thy dwelling shall be the fatness of the earth and of the dew of heaven from above, and by the sword, verse 40, by the sword shalt thou live and shalt serve thy brother. Serve thy brother. Those are bitter words, aren't they? And it shall come to pass when thou shalt have the dominion that thou shalt break his yoke from off thy neck. Verse 41, and Esau hated Jacob. Why did he hate him? It says, because of the blessing wherewith his father blessed him. And Esau said in his heart, that's where it starts. Did you ever throw a fit? I don't mean lately. Hopefully not lately. Did you ever throw a fit, kick something, punt something? Something was brewing there in your heart, and then it came out. You didn't want to hurt anybody else, and you didn't know how to handle it. He
He said, the days of mourning for my father, verse 41, the days of mourning for my father at hand, then will I slay my brother Jacob. Boy, he's got a plan. I think, I'm not sure of this, but I'm pretty sure that every person who's ever murdered had a plan first. They thought about it. Something made them mad. These words of Esau, her elder son, were told to Rebekah, verse 42, and she sent and called Jacob, her younger son, and said unto him, behold, thy brother Esau is touching thee, doth comfort himself, purposing to kill thee. Man, this jumped out too. I felt it had to be dealt with. Rebekah tells Jacob, behold, thy brother Esau, verse 42, as touching thee, doth comfort himself, purposing to kill thee. Comfort himself. If Jacob's dead, Esau feels better. Is that not insane? That's how people think. I told you this story before. I'll tell it again. I preached a meeting. I believe the year was 1984. I was in evangelism. I was in college. I preached for a guy, and he'd say, hey, before we had meetings, that was a great meeting. It went a week, and then we extended it 2 weeks. I preached in chapel, man, kids. It was just a great time. And he would say, hey, before you preach, let's get together and we'll pray. The men will come and we'll pray. Every night we would pray, and the men would pray something like this. Lord, we pray for our pastor that you'll answer this prayer. And some of the men would really pray with intensity concerning the pastor and this problem. I'm sitting in on this for 2 weeks. Pretty soon, I'm curious. I asked, I said, hey, is there anything I can do? I'm kind of puzzled. What's going on? Finally, they said, this is from the men of the church. If you told me this story, I wouldn't believe it. But I have good credibility. You can believe it. Here's what the men of the church said to me. Pastor's praying that his wife dies because he believes there's another woman that God wants him to have. I said, I'm done. This meeting is over. So I checked around. I thought, am I dreaming? I mean, that's the most bizarre thing I've ever heard. So I checked around, talked to some of the ladies. I said, hey, you know anything about this prayer request? They went like this. I said, is that true? They said, well, yeah. I said, what in the world are you doing here? You think the devil's a liar? He's lied to other people, hadn't he? And you and I better not think that we're not sorry. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. You and I better not think we're not so smart. Or that smart that we wouldn't listen to him. You need to hear this again. There's people much smarter than you and I that have fallen for what he's told them. There's men far better than I'll... Listen to me. I mean this with all my heart. I'll put my whole arm in the Bible. Does that count for more? There are men that are far better than I'll ever be who have fallen. And now they're greeting people somewhere. Not a church, a grocery store. I would never hate someone, really. That's funny. That's what every murderer says. I never meant to do it. You say, what's the end of that story? The guy died, the wife is still living, and they were still married. Be careful what you pray for. Let me verify this story. I ran into the gal they were praying about that the pastor said he wanted to have. I asked her. I said, I'm sorry. In my life, I've been through a lot. If you don't mind, I would like to ask you a question. Very personal. She said, I think I know what it is. And she said, yes, that's a true story. I said, that is one of the most ungodliest, wicked things I've ever heard. She said, I didn't think so at the time. I said, exactly. What's that verse? The devil is a sly old fox. If I could catch him, I'd put him in a box. Lock the door and throw away the key. That isn't in the scripture. It ought to be. Lock the door and throw away the key for all the tricks he's played on me. Glad that I'm a Christian. Verse 41, Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing wherewith his father blessed him. And Esau said in his heart, the Bible says, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Your heart deals with everything. Esau said, his heart, the days of mourning of my father at hand, then will I slay my brother Jacob. These words of Esau, her elder son, were told to Rebekah. She sent and called Jacob, her younger son, and said unto him, behold, thy brother Esau, as touching thee, doth comfort himself, purposing to kill thee. I got to finish reading this, but I feel like I can't. Did Esau, this is not a trick question, did Esau have any right to kill his brother? None. Did he have any right to be mad at his brother? Let me help you. None. Great peace of they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. Esau is comforting himself with his plan to make himself feel better. I don't know why I had this dream. Here, let me tell you the dream I had last night. I don't dream. I sleep. And I snore so loud I can't dream. My mind won't work. I dreamed I went down to the kitchen, and I'm pretty sure I didn't. But I'm in my dream, I'm going down to the kitchen. And I see this big black thing that looks like the biggest spider I've ever seen. I hate spiders. They don't talk. You can't hear them. If they would talk and say, I'm coming, they wouldn't be so bad. If they walked real hard so you could hear them, wouldn't be so bad. But if you ever, if you're honest, if you ever woke up and you're sleeping and you wake up and you feel one crawling on your face, and I sleep with my mouth wide open. I mean, you could play putt-putt. I'm wide open, and I'm what? So then I'm thinking, how many spiders have I swallowed? Sometimes you have indigestion. How many bugs? How many stink bugs? I mean, you swallow it? Sometimes you ever wake up going, you just swallowed something. So I have this, don't distract me. So I have this dream that I go down to the kitchen. Well, I don't do that. I sleep very well. I don't get up much. I don't need ice cream or water. I do my thing, sleep. But I have this dream. I get up. I go to the kitchen. I see this thing. It's that big. It's black. And it's a spider, I think. So I walk over to it, and it's a big piece of lint. If you know what that means, tell me what that dream means, because I was up all night trying to figure out what that meant. Clean the house, I guess. Verse 43. Now therefore, my son, obey my voice, and arise, flee thou to Laban, my brother, to Haran, and tarry with him a few days until thy brother's fury turn away, till thy brother's anger turn away from thee, and he forget that which thou hast done to him. Any chance of that happening? When you get that mad, you know, you don't wake up one day and go, I wonder how Jacob's doing. That's right, that dirty rat. You. Let's do two blanks before we finish reading. Let's do this a little different. That okay? First blank. Esau had a problem. And you realize these are not just for fun. This isn't a coloring page at the restaurant. You realize that? I mean, I have a point and a subliminal point that you don't always catch. But this isn't just to teach you about Esau. This is to help teach you about yourself. Esau had a problem, and you might, and I might. What was his problem? He couldn't forgive Jacob. Unforgiveness. That's why the cross is so great. We have received the forgiveness of our sin. God forgave us. The Bible says, Ephesians chapter 4, that we are to forgive even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven us or you. Second blank. Esau ended up living for one thing. Vengeance. Hey, he said, when daddy dies, I'm killing that rat. Verse 46, Rebekah said to Isaac, I'm weary of my life because of the daughters of Heth. If Jacob take a wife of the daughters of Heth, such as daughters of the Lord, what good shall my life do to me? We're not going to get into that. We need to get into the fact that Esau hated Jacob. And boy, I even came up with another page of stuff that I got to deal with. Pray with me. Lord, help me right now. If there's any anger or hurt or hatred in my heart, get it out. If there's anybody else here, God, wrestling with that, struggling, you're the best one to show it. I could stand here and say, I'm not angry at anybody. I don't hate anybody. But you know better than I do. So help me see my heart like you see it. Help us all to see our heart like you see it. Use this time, Lord. We need your help. Our heart's as wicked as Esau's is, or was. I don't want to have that same kind of heart or spirit that he did. Speak to us now, Lord, please, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Do you have a problem forgiving people? You know what road rage is? Road rage is selfishness. I deserve to be there. I deserve to be a, hey, they're fighting on Black Friday. Somebody was shot over something somewhere. Really? Stuff. Toys. Usually toys. Esau, the first thing you saw or we filled in for you was Esau's problem. I don't think he wanted the blessing. If I was his dad, I would say, why'd you sell it to him then? You know, why'd you let him? And no, I'm not justifying Jacob. He's a dirty rat too. You know, I'm a dirty rat. God died for dirty rats. Anybody, any other dirty rats in here? I see a couple, but I want to see if you'll raise your little rat hand. Let me tell you something. I don't even want to go there. This is so. I preached a series on forgiveness many years ago. A guy came up to me and he said, hey, I just want you to know, I heard what you said. He said, but I hate my father and I'll never forgive him. You thought we had a perfect church, didn't you? You thought your pastor was perfect. I said, let me get this straight. Your father's done something so bad to you that you'll never forgive him. He said, that's right. They're not here anymore. I'm not talking about you. Because some of you start looking around going. You're looking at the one, looking for the one that's really sweating. I don't do that. He moved on. Things happened that should have got his attention, by the way, too. It always happens that way. I said, let me get this straight. Your dad did something to you that has caused you to hate him and never forgive him. That's not Bible. That's not Christian. You know what he said? You want to guess? I know. So, well, you know what the Bible says? I know. You know, you need, whether you like me, you need to forgive him. I know. You know that's not right. God can't bless you if you keep that hatred, that anger, that unforgiving spirit in your heart. He said, I know, I know, I know. And then I want to say, turn around, bend over. Maybe that'll help. When I don't forgive, listen very carefully. When I don't forgive, I am the one that is hurt. I lose. But you don't understand. I love that phrase. Just takes care of everything. You don't know what I've gone through. I know this. I know Jesus paid for it all. I know that he's more powerful than anything we go through. I have a wicked, sinful heart, and that will cause me to want to hurt someone else. I don't want to say you have a wicked, I already called you a rat. I got to ease up a little bit. You don't have a wicked, sinful heart. You're the most perfect people I've ever. Forgiving someone when they've been awful to you is not easy. Part of the problem. Part of the problem when we don't forgive. It's never, listen to me. Never them. I mean, you're in control how you respond. You're not in control of half of you, but you're in control of how you respond. So the problem here with unforgiveness is not them. They don't come to you and go, don't you ever forgive me. Don't you ever forgive. No, it's you. And the problem with that is this. We struggle. I just want to see your little minds going. Party, pumpkin. Who do you think you are that you shouldn't forgive? Paul wrote to the churches at Ephesus, one of the best churches in the scriptures, by the way. He said to them, be kind one to another, tenderhearted. He said, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven you. If anybody should have had pride and didn't leave heaven to die for you, it should have been God. We think of our reputation. You know what I hate? When someone hurts me, you know what I hate? It seems like they always end up looking better than I do. Let me give you something else that really bugs me. When I get hurt, you know what seems to happen? When they hurt me, it seems like God ends up blessing them. Better now. Number one. See the word at the end of that line? Enemies. You know what we need to do? Because that, far as I'm concerned, if someone hurts you or that they become an enemy. And the deepest scripture dealing with problem people to me as enemies. And the Bible says, I'm gonna go generic for a minute for that point. But the Bible says what? Pray. Pray for your enemies. I don't have any enemies. You don't. Matthew 5, you know the scripture. Jesus is teaching the Sermon on the Mount. In the 44th verse, he says, "But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you." Esau took advantage. I'm sorry, Jacob took advantage of Esau when Esau was in a weak moment. Then he deceives his own father and steals the blessing. I think it's interesting when Esau said, "Bless me." You know what Isaac says? "I can't." Isaac is following God. Isaac is obeying God. He's fearing God. He's going to do the right thing, even though he was tricked. He can't do a double blessing. He said, "Listen to me. I've been tricked. I'm sorry. But I have to do the right thing." Amy and I talk about this. There are people all around us not doing the right thing. And it makes it easier for us not to do the right thing. But she's heard me say, I've been repeating it constantly. Hey, it doesn't matter what anybody else does, I'm going to do the right thing. Doesn't matter what anybody else does, I'm going to do the right thing. Hey, it doesn't matter what they say, doesn't matter how they're living, doesn't matter what they're trying to get, I'm going to do the right thing. We have to love God more than we love anyone else. And Isaac takes this stand. Esau, verse 34, he heard the words of his father. He cried with a great and exceeding bitter cry and said to his father, "Bless me, even me also. Oh, my father," he said, "thy brother came with subtlety to take away thy blessing." Esau said, "Man, he is a trickster. He is a shyster." He said, two times he got me. And Isaac answered, verse 37, and said, "Behold, I've made him thy Lord." Be consistent. Isaac was consistent. He couldn't say, "All right, let me take that one away." He couldn't do that. Matthew chapter 10, I want to read this scripture. You could jot it, listen, turn to it if you wish. Matthew chapter 10, verse 34. Says, "Think not that I'm come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword." Jesus said, "I've came to set a man at variance against his father, the daughter against her mother, the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's foes should be they of his own household. He that loveth father," watch now, you're all hung up about that, but then Jesus says, Matthew 10, verse 37, "He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. He that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. He that findeth his life shall lose it. He that loses his life for my sake shall find it." Pray for your enemies. I want to get through this second point because I don't think I'm going to get through the other page of stuff, but I'd like to. Forgive. Notice the word is forgive. Pray for your enemies. Pray for your enemies. I'm throwing that out. I'm going to spend probably next week. I'm going to spend probably the whole class on how to pray for your enemies. Because some of you are, "I'm not coming then because I don't have any enemies." Don't come then. What do you want me to say? Don't come. Why we struggle. That's what I made the point. Say it doesn't rhyme. It's not, I know. Why we struggle. Forgive. Let me ask you a question. Could Esau have forgiven Jacob? There was nothing that says that he couldn't. There are, I've jotted down three reasons that we struggle to forgive. Number one, you got this? If you don't, we'll write faster. Number one, self-pity. That's an interesting Hebrew word in verse 42. These words of Esau, our eldest son, were told Rebekah. She sent, called Jacob, her younger son. And Rebekah tells Jacob, she said, "Thy brother Esau is touching thee, doth comfort himself, purposing to kill thee." He's thinking about him. He wants to make himself feel better. You know why a person drinks? They want to make themselves feel better. You know why they go out, get drunk, can't drive, and kill someone? Because they're thinking about them. They're not thinking about killing somebody. You know why a person does drugs? Because they're thinking about them. You know why a guy cheats on his wife? Thinking about him. You know why we aren't unforgiving? You know why we're not forgiving? Help me. Pray for me. I got so much on my mind. Notes and turkey, and I can't wait home to get have a. The kids came to the church Thursday night and said, "Hey, we're all going to play Nerf." I said, "You guys go have fun." They text, "Hey, you coming?" I said, "Can't make it." I said, "What'd you do?" I stayed home and ate pumpkin pie. Play Nerf, get shot in the eye, go blind. See, I always think the worst. Comfort, verse 42, comfort comes from two words, self and sorry, self-sorry. Feeling sorry. Did your mom ever say it to you? Quit feeling sorry for yourself. I'm good at it, man. I still practice. I still like to get some practice in. So I'm up on that. But we're good at self-pity. What's wrong with you? Oh, I'm okay. Don't you just want to slap those people? You know, I mean, it should be, "Hey, no, why? Why, everything's fine." But you go, "Hey, you okay?" "Yeah." Oh. Self-pity. That's why we struggle with forgiving someone, because we're thinking about us. We're all wrapped up. Hey, listen to me. If alcohol tasted like sauerkraut juice. Some of you like that, though. If it tasted like poison, the worst thing they ever drank, they never drank. They drank because to them, it does two things. Oh, they like the taste, they say, and it makes them feel good. But to me, self-pity's not much different. Look up there. Self-pity's not much different than self-love. Like saying we don't deserve what happened to us. You know what that is? Self-righteousness. Number two, why we struggle with forgiving someone. I get it. Jealousy. Bible talk about jealousy. Did you ever anybody have a Bible in this room? Did you ever read through it? Did you ever see the word envy or jealous? Jealousy is a weird thing, man. I have those tendencies. Preachers are jealous of other preachers. Amy said something interesting to me. She said, I'm just repeating, I'm not saying that this. I don't need a raise. Well, no, I need a raise, but she said, you know, We noticed that she's very perceptive. We've been in the ministry, and she lives with the smartest guy that I think has ever been born. And humble. She said, you know, a lot of these preachers are trying to be somebody else. They won't just self-identify. They won't be. And she said, I think a lot of them are jealous of you because you're just who you are. I said, man, I never, you know, I'm jealous of a guy that has a bigger church. I'm jealous of a guy that could preach better. I'm jealous of a guy that could preach a shorter sermon. Jealousy's everywhere. Christmas causes that. Huh? Watch your kids. Buy your kids different things. Buy one kid better stuff than the other kid. Watch them. You think they're going to go, oh, God bless my dear brother who got more than I did? Are you kidding? They'll tear the tree down. They'll eat the Christmas lights. Jealousy will cause that. The Bible says envy is the rottenness of the bones. It rots your bones. Esau wanted a blessing. Can you blame him? He wanted a blessing. He's jealous that his brother got it. Number three, we got to quit. Another reason we don't forgive. Or we struggle with it. Not just angry. We get mad at God. I know, so I love it because some of you think, if we say that out loud, will we die? No, because I've said it and you don't die. And if you do die, just make sure you're going to heaven. Bow your head real quick, make sure you're going to heaven. Do you think Esau thought, why would God let this happen? Did you ever go through that? Lose somebody? Think, how could this happen? Why would God let this happen? Then I thought of Psalm 31. Listen, would you? Psalm 31, verse 1. In thee, O Lord, do I put my trust. Let me never be ashamed. Deliver me in thy righteousness. Bow down thine ear to me. Deliver me speedily. Be thou my strong rock. For in a house of defense to save me. For thou art my rock and my fortress. Therefore, for thy name's sake, lead me and guide me. Pull me out of the net that they've laid privily for me. For thou art my strength. Into thine hand I commit my spirit. Thou hast redeemed me, O Lord God of truth. I've hated them that regard lying vanities, but I trust in the Lord. Verse 7, I will be glad and rejoice in thy mercy, for thou hast considered my trouble. Thou hast considered my trouble. Thou hast known my soul in adversity. I don't have time. I'm not going to rush it. I'm sorry. And rush it. Pray with me. Father, I pray that we will be willing to be helped. And God, I just pray that we'll get better even this week at praying for our enemies and not struggling to forgive. You're the one that can give us the victory. You're the only one. Give us the victory in that, please. I pray and I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.